Are we ready to go? All right. Good evening, everyone. The Department of American Studies welcomes you to the annual David Noble Lecture. My name is Bianca Castellanos, and I'm the Chair of American Studies and Director of the Institute for Advanced Study. We're going to do our best to offer descriptions of what you might see on stage and on your screen today. That includes me. So I'm a brown-skinned woman with black hair, wearing dark black glasses, and a light blue jacket. I'd like to begin by acknowledging that I'm speaking from the ancestral and contemporary homelands of Dakota people. Land acknowledgments are just a beginning for respectfully recognizing Dakota people's history on this land and their sovereignty. The Department of American Studies is committed to working with tribal nations to affirm tribal sovereignty, reckon with this painful past, and counter historical and contemporary injustices. One concrete way that we do this is to recruit and support Native and Indigenous students in our graduate program. In American Studies, we use race, indigeneity, gender, sexuality, and disability as analytics to understand America's past, present, and future. Thus, we are committed to acknowledging and denouncing historic and contemporary forms of racial injustice in the city where we work. We stand in solidarity with the families of George Floyd, Dante Wright, Jamar Clark, and Philando Castile, as well as many others whose loved ones have been killed by police violence in Minnesota. The annual David Noble Lecture is held in honor of our dear friend and colleague David Noble, whose scholarship interrogated American exceptionalism and really was a model for how we do American studies today. David may no longer be with us, but he is here with us in spirit. And we're also fortunate that we have some of David's family here with us today. David wrote some of the most defining texts in American studies, including but not limited to The Paradox of Progressive Thought, Historians Against History, The End of American History, Democracy, Capitalism, and a Metaphor for Two Worlds in Anglo-American Historical Writing, Death of a Nation, American Culture and the End of Exceptionalism, and his most recent book, Debating the End of History, The Marketplace, Utopia, and the Fragmentation of Intellectual Life. And before we begin, I'd just like to make one brief announcement in my role as director of the IAS. We hope you will join us on Thursday, April 6th, for the last Spotlight Series event exploring the 2023 theme, The Human in the Data. This event will speak in layman's terms about the role of big data in brain research. And we will also be taking questions in person and online after Jason Ruiz's presentation. For those of you online, I invite you to use the Q&A section in the Zoom to ask a question. And for those of you here in person, we'll be able to use a microphone. We are grateful to our co-sponsors, the Institute for Advanced Study, the Departments of Chicano and Latino Studies, Political Science, English, Cultural Studies and Comparative Literature, and Geography, Environment, and Society, and the Hubbard School of Journalism and Mass Communication. And now, without further delay, I'm very pleased to introduce today's moderator, Kevin Murphy. Kevin Murphy is Northrop Professor, Professor of History, and Affiliate Professor of American Studies at the University of Minnesota. He also co-founded UMN's Heritage Studies and Public History Graduate Program, and is currently the Faculty Director of the Liberal Arts Engagement Hub. Kevin has published in the fields of public history, gender history, and queer studies. He's the author of Political Manhood, Red Bloods, Mollycoddles, and the Politics of Progressive Era Reform, and with the Twin Cities GLBT Oral History Project, Queer Twin Cities, which was published by the University of Minnesota Press. His work appears in academic journals, including the Oral History Review, Critical Ethnic Studies, and the Radical History Review. He has co-edited a number of anthologies and special journal issues on the history of sexuality, including most recently, The Rutledge History of American Sexuality with Jason Ruiz and David Serlin. And he's also a core member of Minnesota Transform. Please join me in welcoming Kevin.
So it's my honor and great pleasure to introduce University of Minnesota American Studies PhD and my friend and collaborator, Dr. Jason Ruiz. Dr. Ruiz is Associate Professor and Chair of American Studies at the University of Notre Dame, where he is affiliated faculty with the program in Gender Studies and the Institute for Latino Studies. Jason's research focuses on American American perceptions of Latin America with emphases on race, cultural and economic imperialism, tourism, gender, and sexuality. His first book, Americans in the Treasure House, Travel to Porfirian Mexico and the Cultural Politics of Empire, which began as his dissertation here at Minnesota, was published by the University of Texas Press in 2014. Dr. Ruiz has also published in the Radical History Review, American Studies, the Journal of Transnational American Studies, the Oral History Review, and elsewhere. In addition, he's the co-editor of many special issues and books. These include 4 issues of the Radical History Review, Queer Twin Cities, published by the University of Minnesota Press, and the Routledge History of American Sexuality. Dr. Ruiz is also a prolific scholar. Sometimes he's referred to as a Netflix expert, offering commentary to the New York Times, Flow TV, the Chronicle of Higher Education, and many other media outlets. Dr. Ruiz has also made major contributions in the public humanities and as a teacher. He's the principal investigator in a really incredible project that's called Latino Murals of Pilsen, a digital research project devoted to public art in Chicago, supported by the Whiting Foundation. Dr. Ruiz has also been honored with 2 major teaching awards at Notre Dame. In 2016, he received the Edmund P. Joyce Award, which recognizes excellence in undergraduate teaching. And in 2019, he received the Reverend Charles B. Sheedy Award, which is presented annually to one outstanding educator who has sustained excellence in research and instruction. Tonight, Dr. Ruiz will present from his forthcoming book, Narco-Media, Latinidad, Popular Culture, and America's War on Drugs. And that book will be coming out very soon in October with the University of Texas Press. So without further ado, Jason Ruiz.
Thank you, Bianette and Kevin. Thank you for the invitation today. It's really great to be here for so many reasons, especially see so many old friends, grad school friends, undergrad friends, high school friends, the reason I moved to Minneapolis in the first place. Really want to thank you for being here. Any chance to talk with folks here at the U, my very beloved double alma mater, is exciting, but to be here under the auspices of a lecture named for David Noble, it means more than I can possibly convey. He taught my very first graduate school class I ever attended, I think the day after September 11th, 2001. I just want to say how much I learned from David and how much I learned from this program that he helped really shape for so many decades. Thank you so much. What an honor to be here to speak in a lecture named for a brilliant and, just as importantly, a very kind man. Thank you. Specifically for bringing me here today, I want to thank the Department of American Studies and the Institute for Advanced Studies and everyone who worked on the logistics for bringing me here, including the wonderful Bianette, of course, and James and Clarence for all of the logistics. To be introduced by Kevin is a little overwhelming because we have worked so long together and so fruitfully together. And I realize I haven't had that many opportunities to publicly thank him. Kevin has been a first responder throughout my entire academic career, from my many disappointments to the triumphs that I've had in my career. And I consider tonight a triumph, so thank you for that. My presentation is drawn from my forthcoming book, as Kevin mentioned, which is titled which is advancing a theory of a body of text that I call narco-media. As you can see from the slide, in the book I'm interested in a large body of cultural works that portray Latinos and Latin Americans in relation to America's long-doomed, the war on drugs. In the book, which will be published in October, as Kevin mentioned, as part of the Latinx, The Future Is Now series at the University of Texas Press, I trace a large body of these cultural texts that I argue have framed Latinos, Latinas, Latin America, Latinx people, Latinidad as the villains in the war on drugs. I adamantly propose more broadly that the war on drugs has been fought on the cultural front as much as in the realms of, say, politics and economics. I'm really advancing an argument here that we can't look at the war on drugs without also understanding the cultural politics that come along with it. So I want to start by showing you three guiding principles that are really shaping how I even start to approach something as long, complicated, meandering, and problematic as the war on drugs. So I'm going to give you just three guiding principles just to get myself started here. The first one is that the war on drugs has been fought in the cultural arena since the 1970s. It's a common misunderstanding that, or common claim that Richard Nixon coined the term war on drugs. He declared a national emergency over war on drugs, over drugs in 1971, but he never used the word war on drugs. That didn't happen until the 80s, when it really accelerated under President Ronald Reagan. First argument here is that we can't understand the war on drugs without also understanding the ways that the work of Nancy Reagan, for example, helped really to make the war on drugs a cultural war as well. I'm a child of the 80s. I know some of you are my age in the room, and you might remember the fact that the government very explicitly turned to culture as a way in which to convince many Americans to resist drugs. Speaking of resisting drugs, I think this is, the DARE program is the perfect example of this. I've given this lecture a couple of times to undergraduates, and I'm really amazed that new freshmen at Notre Dame have often attended the DARE program. I'm wondering if I could see a show of hands in this room. I know this doesn't help the Zoom people. If anyone here was a DARE kid, I was a DARE kid in East Chicago, Indiana. Okay, a few of you. DARE is the perfect example of the government using the cultural front to convince America's school children not to do drugs. Now, the research on DARE is extensive and pretty damning because it shows that the DARE program has actually introduced drugs to a lot of school children. That's a story for another day. My second guiding principle with which I approach this work is to argue that since the 19th century, pop culture in the US has linked drugs to immigrants and people of color. Of course, many examples abound by this. The cultural figure of the Chinese opium den, for example, in the late 19th and early 20th century. Here's a picture postcard that was sold as part of tourism in San Francisco's Chinatown. The Chinese opium den, of course, a classic example that leads to a lot of other pop culture that framed the Chinese immigrant population as particularly threatening to the US body politic, because not only for all the other things that we know that were associated with the Chinese that led to Chinese exclusion, but drugs, in particular opium, was a major factor in helping to convince many Americans to fully exclude the Chinese during this time period, during the late 19th and early 20th century. This comes with popular culture. My third guiding principle is a little more contemporary, and it argues that non-white people and immigrants continue to be disproportionately policed and sentenced for drug offenses in the United States. Of course, you can probably imagine the example I'm about to give you, which is crack cocaine versus powder cocaine, which comes to it with an 18-to-1 sentence disparity. As you know, crack being associated with, you know, urban problem, I'm putting scare quotes around this, urban problems, African-American communities versus the sort of powder cocaine, which is considered more of a white drug. We have mandatory prison sentences right now today in the United States that that criminalize crack cocaine far more dramatically than they criminalize powder cocaine. I'm interested in the bigger question of how we got here. How did we get to this point where drugs are racialized and drugs come to represent so much more than just the substances that people consume? And I'm really asking whether or not we can link the disparities in how drugs are policed and punished to perceptions of narcotics that circulate in American popular culture and media representations really that now go globally. I know there's a scholar of Latin American media here. I'm preaching to the choir. It's hard to even describe how Netflix, for example, as a US cultural product, when Netflix is such a global property or media conglomerate with a global audience. I'm interested in this question of how do we link perceptions of drugs with the media representations we produce? And no matter how you answer this initially, I think it's pretty obvious that we're living in a moment right now, and this is kind of where I started the book project, to think about the ways that we're living in a moment where drug narratives are everywhere around us, especially in this era of so-called prestige television and streaming media. My book, Narco-Media, asks how we got here. How did we get so interested in drug narratives? A place where I start might surprise some of you and might not surprise others, which is I start the book looking at it with two chapters that look at representations of Miami in the early 1980s. When cocaine reemerged in the US in the 1970s, most media representations described it as an elite party drug, non-addictive and non-threatening to public health. However, starting in the first few years of the 1980s, public opinion really began to shift around cocaine and the apparent threat that it posed to the US body politic, especially when crack emerged in the middle of the decade. And throughout the 1980s, one urban expanse in the US really came to represent Americans' coke problem, Miami and Dade County. In 1980, Miami's sunny reputation was clouded by two key events that brought South Florida considerable attention: the race riots of May of that year and the Mariel boat lift, which lasted from spring to fall of the same year. In May of 1980, thousands of Miamians rioted for several days when an all-white jury acquitted four Dade County police officers who had been on trial for the beating death of Arthur McDuffie, a black motorcyclist who had been pulled over for traffic violations late the previous year. The riots brought racial disparities in Miami to national attention and created a sense for many years to come that the city's racial tensions could bubble to the surface at any time. The Miami riots of 1980, there's many Miami riots over the course of the 80s, but the 1980 riots was the deadliest riot of the entire 1980s in America. The Mariel boat lift, on the other hand, was really several months of departures from Cuba to the United States in a movement of people that was negotiated by both governments. In all, over the course of 1980, approximately 125,000 refugees migrated to South Florida as part of a huge effort that forever changed the population dynamics of the region, especially the Cuban American community. The boat lift, as I argue, was in fact a highly mediated historical event. It didn't just happen in a vacuum. It was on TV every night for many months over the course of the 1980s, or of 1980, and then even its aftermath in well into the 80s. It was video broadcast all over the world. Many media outlets mistakenly depicted the Marielitos, as the refugees are known, as quote unquote undesirables who had been evicted by Castro because of their criminal backgrounds, creating an impression among the public that the boat lift was the result of Castro opening the prison gates and exporting the worst elements of Cuban society to the US. In fact, the scholarship now shows that the refugee population did not have a particularly high rate of incarceration prior to the boat lift, and most Marielitos who did have criminal backgrounds had been charged with false or minor crimes, from speaking out against the government to homosexuality. Even so, images of the Marielitos in the news combined with images of tens of thousands of so-called boat people who fled Haiti in the 1970s and 1980s to create an overall impression to some that South Florida was under siege by racial and ethnic others. This is actually the opening image of my chapter that I'm going to talk about today, this idea of South Florida as paradise lost. I do an extensive description of representations of South Florida prior to the 1980s. So in the 50s, actually the very same magazine, Time, positioned South Florida as this kind of like earthly paradise with amazing agricultural opportunities, of course, perfect weather. But the narrative really started to shift in the early 1980s based on some of these political factors that I'm talking about. Here you can see some of the footage. I hope you can see this, whether you're on Zoom or in person. I hope you can see some of the hysteria that is being fomented in Time magazine, very mainstream news source at the time, to position South Florida as a place in terrible danger. The November 23rd, 1981 edition of Time, which these are from, like countless other articles and news segments, portrayed the area as a place that was totally out of control with crime and violence, and as the worst example of the United States' growing drug problem. And importantly, as I hope you can see here a little bit, they fixated on racial difference and the supposed dangerous effects of mass migration as a key component of what made Miami so dangerous at the time. This brings me to a certain text I'm going to talk about in the presentation today. It's familiar to some of you, I'm sure. Brian De Palma's Scarface, a 1983 remake of the classic 1932 gangster film by Howard Hawks, is really what I'm going to focus on for the rest of my time in the presentation. Out of the cultural and social context of South Florida as Paradise Lost, there emerged a cycle of film and TV texts that focused and fixated on Miami as the entry point for drugs in the United States. This text comes to mind, this other text might come to mind, which is in fact the basis of the second chapter of my book, but really Scarface is where I begin my study of these texts and the ones that followed. When I'm watching the movie, I'm always surprised, when I'm teaching the movie, I'm always surprised that a lot of my students at Notre Dame have seen Scarface for reasons that I'll talk about at the end of the presentation. So I hope that Scarface looks familiar to some of you because I can't show you the entire almost 3-hour movie, but I'm gonna show you just about a minute and 58 seconds of it in a few minutes. Scarface was actually only a minor hit at the time of its release over Christmas of 1983, but it has had an incredible afterlife in the intervening decades, growing slowly but steadily into an icon of its genre. However, the film has also mystified the few critics who have asked what it has to say about race, ethnicity, and especially Latinidad. I want to stress in my chapter and in the book in general and in other work I've done on Scarface, Latinidad is actually a central theme of the film and one that I want to tease out today in the presentation. This is nothing new because, in fact, Scarface was already an ethnic film. The 1932 version, which I happen to think is a masterpiece of its genre, but it's about a different ethnic other. It is about Paul Mooney as Tony Camonte, an Italian-American immigrant to Chicago in the early 1930s. The original film's Tony Camonte in the 1982-83 version goes from Tony Camonte to Tony Montana, a Marielito who wreaks havoc on Miami as the cocaine trade expands in the city. The film traces his rise from a recently arrived refugee to a drug kingpin addicted to his own product, to his demise at the hands of South American foot soldiers from a rival cartel. There is a lot going on in Scarface in terms of the politics of representation. But I want to focus here on how Scarface relates to the cultural politics of what Leo Chavez calls the Latino threat narrative. That's probably going to make some people dizzy if I keep it on the GIF. Sorry about that. Chavez locates that narrative, the Latino threat narrative, which frames Latinos and Latinidad as intrinsically threatening to the U.S. in news coverage. But I want to stress that Scarface, like other pop culture texts of the 80s, perfectly articulates the Latino threat narrative in a fictional film world meant to convey that Latinos are threatening in particular for the roles that they play in the importation and distribution of illicit narcotics. Making Tony Montana a Marielito explicitly tapped into ideas that were already circulating about the refugee crisis precipitated by the boat lift, especially among conservative media outlets and politicians, and I have to say, the existing Cuban refugee population in South Florida, which was extraordinarily nervous about how to fully incorporate financially strapped and politically suspect refugees into their relatively prosperous settlement in South Florida. I want to illustrate the idea of the Marielitos as a threat and some of this cultural politics I'm talking about by showing you just under 2 minutes of the film, in fact, the first 2 minutes of the film. What I'm about to show you is the film's two-thirds of the film's three-minute prologue and opening credits. This bit of film text will reveal some of the issues that I'm dealing with all throughout the book, including the lines between fact and fiction in depictions of the war on drugs, and Latinos being positioned as a social problem, including narratives about migration and belonging. So as you watch the start of the prologue of the film, I'd really appreciate it if you could note how filmmakers tap into those tropes regarding Latinx migration that came before and after this appeared in 1983.
Thank you. queremos, no los necesitamos.
Okay, I realize I've manipulated you because I couldn't stop myself from cutting it at the American flag. I mean, I'm a product of this PhD program in American Studies, couldn't help it. But I wanted you to see that the film starts with documentary footage, because documentary footage is so important to my study of narco-media. From here, where I start up to more recent texts like El Patrón del Mal, which is a Colombian telenovela focused on Pablo Escobar, to the series Narcos, that was a major hit on Netflix. So many of these texts use documentary footage to kind of really root the film text in kind of truthiness, in this sort of like this newsiness that I think is very much essential to the story of narco-media. Five documentary news bureaus furnish the footage that you just saw in the opening to Scarface. And it would have looked very familiar to audiences in 1983 who had seen a lot of these types of images on the news, on the nightly news. Crowded boats teeming with migrants desperate to make it to American soil. Images that had convinced many that the Marielitos should have been rejected or were somehow unassimilable. I see the film as tapping into deeper narratives about who the Marielitos were and whether they could become assimilable into the US. As you can see from this slide, I got my hands on a copy of the screenplay, and I found something really, really interesting at work here. I don't know if you can read it. I don't know if I can read it because it's so small on my own screen. But here, it was supposed to be a voiceover narrative accompanying that scrolling, like Star Wars style text. And the very last line that Oliver Stone, who wrote the screenplay and who has gone on record many times to say that he wrote the screenplay after watching the news and seeing the Marielitos on the news, when he wrote the screenplay in 1980, 1981, on a cocaine bender, according to his memoir, he wrote that the last line of that prologue that you read, which was cut for the final film, reads, "This is a story of that minority." So it says that 125 people, 1,000 people, most of them had criminal records, according to the screenplay, and then it ends with, "This is the story of that minority, those that they call los bandidos." There's a sort of generalization of what's going on. It's saying not only that this is a Marielito, it's saying this is the story of the Marielitos, something that I find is consistent throughout the film, representing Tony Montana, this out of control eventual drug lord and eventual who's slain, you know, in the drug trade, as being deeply exemplary of not only one person's story, but standing in for the Marielitos in general. As a result, without this sentence, as I've been claiming, the story of Tony Montana comes to stand in more generally for those 125,000 Marielitos. By cutting the single sentence, De Palma entirely changes what the film has to say about that population. It's especially revealing that the 2 hours and 47 minutes that follow the clip that I showed you in this title sequence tell the story of a particularly dangerous Marielito. If I had more time, I would show you more of the film, but I'm hoping that some of you are familiar with that story of Tony Montana as this very out of control, dangerous person. I also can't resist showing you that the original Scarface in 1932 also started with a prologue, a written prologue, that kind of challenged viewers to, you can see on the third part, it says, what are you going to do about it? This is partly due to the Hays Code, is partly due to the censorship. The original Scarface is sometimes called the most censored film in US history, but they kind of wrote this prologue to get out of some censorship stuff. But it really, I think, to me, it puts the text in conversation that they're both trying to have this kind of informative mission about a dangerous population in ways that I think are really complicated. I want to posit that Latinx media and cultural studies should take Scarface seriously. Sometimes the film is dismissed as a schlocky relic, but I think it's really important for a lot of reasons. And one that I'm going to mention is the fact that it got a lot of attention from many sources, but I want to point out this source. This is not related to Scarface, but this was a study done at Florida International University that shows that the population dynamics of South Florida in the 1980s up to over the second half of the 20th century up to 2005. And if you can see where that red line crosses over the blue line, that is exactly the moment in which the Hispanic population of South Florida is becoming bigger than the white population of South Florida. So if I'm placing these texts in a time and place, South Florida, the 1980s, they come at exactly the moment where many people are very nervous about the shifting population dynamics and about the fact that white people are in fact becoming the minority in South Florida. I argue that we have to look at pop culture texts like Scarface and Miami Vice in relation to anxieties around Florida and the United States becoming blacker and browner, a precursor to what would become known as white replacement theory. In my chapter on Miami Vice, for example, I argue that the character of Sonny Crockett represents nostalgia for an imagined old Florida, and that the show consistently places Crockett in danger by putting him in contact with black and brown characters. The bigger point in relation to that text and Scarface is that popular culture narrated the war on drugs through a racialized lens that presumed black and brown criminality and the intrinsic threat that non-white actors in the drug trade posed to the U.S. body politic. The racial politics that congealed around South Florida in the early 90s, in the early 80s, persist even in our streaming era of television. And I can't help but point out Narcos and other texts, including Breaking Bad, that also put white protagonists in conflict and confrontation with non-white villains who are presumed to be more threatening. Pablo Escobar, many characters in Breaking Bad, for example. I want to argue that the racial politics of Scarface are actually very much at play in the streaming era of television, including those texts I just mentioned. I should mention here that the Cuban American community in South Florida was already very organized in the early 1980s and had very extensive, there were multiple competing newspapers and magazines devoted to that community. So I went to the University of Miami a couple years ago looking for evidence of how the Cuban American population might have possibly responded to Scarface. And I found hundreds of examples of news coverage in Spanish language news coverage of Cuban Americans looking at Scarface. They normally called him cara cortada, which I particularly like, literally cut face. And as you can see in this slide, which exemplifies a lot of the coverage, many of these articles focused on Latinx members of the cast and marveled that their own community was the focus of Hollywood attention. But here is where I introduce you to one of the most interesting real-life characters in my entire book. Much of the coverage in the Cuban-American press centered on the efforts of Demetrio Perez, Miami's first Cuban-American city commissioner. Perez died just 2 weeks ago, so I feel a little weird giving this part of the presentations, but he really emerged as a cultural worker that had a lot to say about Scarface in 1983, so I very respectfully, I want to tell you a little bit about him. He had arrived in Miami in 1962, when at the age of 16, he emigrated from Cuba as part of Operation Pedro Pan, the mass evacuation of at least 14,000 6,000 Cuban youths from the island between 1960 and 1962. By the start of the 1980s, he was among the most powerful Cuban Americans in the city and an outspoken, self-appointed protector of the community's public image. In 1981, he was elected to the city commission. The very next year, Perez learned the details about the making of Scarface, the remake of Scarface, and he started a multi-front war against Brian De Palma, the director, and Martin Bregman, the film's main producer. He used the Cuban American press as a platform for his many complaints against what he saw as a potentially harmful representation of the community, and attempted to leverage his political clout to get the producers to agree to a list of seven demands about the production and the content of the film. I hate when people show me slides that are too wordy. I can't resist it. I'll tell you just a couple. On here, you can see that he's demanding that Stone, De Palma, and the producers make Scarface, the Tony Montana character, into a pro-Castro infiltrator trying to bring communism to South Florida. It said that it could not possibly include a favorable representation of communism. He wanted some of the funding to go directly into the Cuban American population. This is a city commissioner writing to the producers, making demands about what they should do with Scarface. He got nowhere, by example. I actually found out about Demetrio Perez when a friend of ours sent me the transcript of a very heated Miami City Council meeting in 1980, where the mayor, who was also Latino, is yelling at Perez to shut up because Miami was going to lose $5 million from the filming. As you saw, at the top of the list was the demand that the Tony Montana character should be rewritten. He wrote to the New York Times. He wrote to the Miami Herald. He wrote in English. He wrote in Spanish. He was sort of a one-man campaign against Scarface. Ultimately, his criticism of the film had a double result. On one hand, to my great surprise when I embarked on this part of the research, his crusade did not resonate with the Cuban American community, or at least the Cuban American press. So this is actually pretty exemplary of the type of coverage that I saw in relation to Perez and the film. This is the Cuban American press saying that Perez himself is damaging the community. And isn't it ironic that someone who fled a dictatorship is trying to tell artists what they can write in their film? So there was this really big backlash in the Miami Herald Spanish edition, and as well as the smaller publications that circulated for the Cuban American population all over South Florida, that were mad not at the film, but at Perez himself. My surprise over this stems from what I had read about first wave refugees and the politics of respectability. So I had initially assumed that the established Cuban American community would be really leery of the film's production. But as you can see, this really was not the case. This is the one that you're looking at is an op-ed by a reporter and columnist named Nicolas Rios, who was a very prominent commentator in South Florida at the time, who opined that it was actually Perez, not Bregman, Stone, or Pacino, that was damaging the image of the community. In this article, he makes a case that Perez was advocating for the exact mode of censorship that he, Perez, like Rios and most other Cuban refugees, criticized about the Castro regime. Rios was not alone in pointing out this irony. And again, to my surprise, many other Spanish language journalists in South Florida accused him in siding with the filmmakers rather than Perez. This was, in fact, one of the most shocking things I really found in my research. There's a number of potential explanations for this, chief among them being the fact that many in the established Cuban exile community were highly protective of their community's image and invested in being accepted and assimilated as good citizens of South Florida. They were already nervous or hostile about the arrival of the Marielitos, and it is well documented in both English and Spanish language sources that they produced their own sort of heavy discourse and rhetoric criticizing the Marielito plan and criticizing and being openly hostile to the arrival of the Marielitos. In a sense, for Cuban Americans focused on assimilation and respectability, Scarface reinforced their own long-standing prejudices against the newcomers who were less prosperous, respectable, and white back on the island. Perez's outspoken criticism simply did not appeal to them because the movie did not challenge their views that the Marielitos were dangerous and undesirable potential threats to the community. However, in another really big way, Perez did get his way, so he kind of lost because he did not get his community behind him. But he did win because his demands led to a series of tense meetings between the film's producers and city officials, who begged them not to pull production from the city. There's actually telegrams between the mayor's office and the producers saying, please, we'll shut up Perez, we'll get rid of him, we'll do anything you want. Film Scarface in Miami, but it doesn't happen. After several of these meetings, telegrams between Miami and Hollywood, spicy interviews in the national press, producer Martin Begerman had finally had enough, and just weeks before shooting was to begin, he relocated the entire production to Los Angeles. Of the nearly 3-hour film, only about 4 minutes that you see in the current production were filmed in Miami, specifically the famous chainsaw scene filmed in Miami Beach. So only 4 minutes of 2 hours and 47 minutes. As a result of the debacle, interestingly, Miami-Dade established a film commission to deal with future productions, and just months after Scarface's premiere, the new film commission rolled out the red carpet for the production team of Miami Vice, which received extensive tax breaks and public boosterism from the mayor and the governor, both of whom praised the TV show's entertainment value and gritty veracity. There's a lot of evidence about this, that the mayor's office worked as paid consultants on Miami Vice, so they actually profited from the production. And the mayor himself even wrote op-eds in the Miami Herald, sort of championing the series. In the chapter on Scarface, I insist that we have to consider Perez's actions, for better or worse, as a form of media activism. This is actually pretty fitting for the first chapter of the book, because throughout Narco-Media, I'm careful to highlight that Latinos have never been the unwitting dupes of pop culture. Following groundbreaking work like that of media historian Chan Noriega and a new wave of works by Angered Valdivia, María Elena Cepeda, Camila Fojas, and others, I look for the ways that Latinos have been active agents in the making of Narco-Media and fierce critics of those texts when necessary. Perez's efforts, in my opinion, were misguided, but they do matter, and they serve as an object lesson for how minoritized communities navigate the politics of representation and respectability. The politics of representation and media activism, like those that I've mentioned here, are just the start of what I look at in the book. In subsequent chapters, I look at how Latinx groups have participated in, consumed, and resisted Narco-Media representation, including Colombian Americans and Mexican Americans and many other groups. I also examine how Latinx representational politics intersect with other identity groups that have stood up for better and fairer representations. For example, the minor backlash to Scarface intersects in some fascinating ways to queer media activism in response to the movie Cruising, which also starred Al Pacino and which was released just a couple of years before Scarface. Finally, I can't help but mention that the need to read and unpack Scarface is as timely as ever, as the film has really spawned an entire mini industry around imitators, including video games. This is a rapper named himself Scarface. Those are video games. Scarface is a popular tattoo motif. A lot of people know this moment of the film in which, you know, Al Pacino says, "Say hello to my little friend." I examine Scarface as a cultural artifact, part of what makes it such a fascinating case study is its pernicious staying power in popular culture. Although the film is now almost exactly 40 years old, it has grown in popularity and is endlessly referenced in memes, video games, and music videos. It has become a popular motif for tattoos, like I've showed you, and its attempts to remake the film are constantly emerging in the Hollywood trade papers over the past decade, with several prominent directors attached to a new remake of Scarface. Just a few months ago, Universal Pictures, which owns the right to Scarface, relaunched a merchandise agreement, which, if you've seen Scarface merchandise in big box retail stores lately, it has to do with this new licensing agreement. I bought a Scarface sweatshirt with a friend in Bogota, but I also saw that they were at Target later. Scarface simply, despite its many problems, has not gone away. The movie's ongoing popularity is relevant for another reason as well. As important research by the Annenberg Inclusion Initiative has shown, at the same time that the movie has resurged, Latinos and Latinas have remained underrepresented and misrepresented in popular media. This disconnect is unfortunate but revealing, as it speaks to the fact that the representational patterns that I've been discussing regarding Scarface are not going anywhere. After surveying hundreds of drug narratives in which Latinx people and communities are represented over the past 5 or 6 years of researching this book, I just can't end this presentation on a positive note, advocating that we can see progress over time. Although I'm heartened by some trends in the era of streaming media and the sort of more complex, more diverse storytelling that's happening, especially on TV right now, I'm also deeply concerned that the stories we tell ourselves about drugs and the drug trade continue to frame Latinos as key progenitors in America's drug problem. It's time that we change the channel on this tired trope and, like Demetrio Perez of all people, start making some demands around the producers of these, the media that we're consuming. So now that my talk is coming to an end, you may be wondering what happened when Scarface finally premiered on Christmas Eve of 1983 in Miami. You might be questioning, was there fallout? Was there protests, boycotts? One reporter at the time wondered the exact same thing and called Perez's office looking for a quote and asking the aide who answered the phone if Perez had relented and just gone to see the movie. The aide told the reporter that the city councilman had actually tried and waited in a very long line to get a ticket, but the movie was sold out all over South Florida. Thank you.
There is a reception following this event outside the theater. I hope people can hear me without the mic. All right, we have a little bit of time for some questions for Dr. Ruiz, both from the audience here and also online.
Professor Ruiz, what a fabulous talk. I really enjoyed it. And I had a comment and then a question. I realized I never saw Scarface, and I was thinking, why didn't I see it? And then I remembered, oh yeah, that's when I was in grad school, and everybody said it was a racist film and blah, blah, blah. And there was some kind of protest in Oakland that some grad students went to, and the Oakland cops beat them up. Yeah. But the question is, as I was watching this, I was thinking, you know, you go all the way back to the opium dens, all the way forward. What is the fascination with drugs? Like, why this fascination? Like, why do we keep making movies about it? Why does that keep happening? What is this fascination? Because I think you're absolutely right. It gets tied historically to people of color, and they become the criminal, the bad guy, blah, blah, blah. But why do movies and Netflix and all these things, why do they keep doing it?
I love that question. You know, and it's of course haunting me as I finish this book and think about publishing it. Like, why do we keep telling stories about drugs over and over again? And the pop culture from the early 20th century and the 19th century, I mean, there's so much of that. There was a cocaine craze in the 1910s that led to a lot of pop culture and eventually led to federal legislation against, like, that created, like, the restrictions on cocaine entering in 1914. Why do we keep doing this? I don't know, I'm working on it, but here's what I think. I think that representations of drugs are never just about the drugs, they're about so much more. So Scarface is not about just the cocaine trade and one fictional kingpin. It's about the problems of South Florida, and it's tapping into kind of cultural anxieties and generated by the news, generated by the bigger conversation that's happening in the United States around the Marilitos, around the Browning of South Florida, which was, as you saw, if you looked really closely at the chart, very, very white in the 1950s. By the 1980s, it was a very different story. So I watched Miami Vice several times over so that you don't have to. And there's a lot of references in that to, as I mentioned kind of in the talk, to like old Florida, that Sonny Crockett is a product of these, the old days of the 1950s in South Florida. He's supposed to be like captain of the football team. And some people have even questioned like the name Sonny Crockett. Okay, like it connotes the weather, it connotes like Davy Crockett, like there's a huge Miami Vice fandom and scholarship fandom that I won't go into. But I think the best answer I have for you is that these are not only about drugs, they're about the news, they're about how we racialize, how we deal with populations. Narcos would be another example, a more recent text. You know, Narcos is about, the first two seasons are about Colombia in the 1990s, and it's not only about cocaine, it's about Plan Colombia, it's about US intervention in Colombia, in subtle ways. It's about a lot more than just one person named Pablo Escobar. Dr. Feeney.
At least here, just to ask you, if, when you say representations of Miami were all about being something whiter and sunnier in the 50s, I just, my mind jumps to Key Largo, and I'm sure that'll be a lot of people's, you know, association. It seems to me a good, and there were a number of movies made around the same time, like I think there was one called The Gun Runners about smuggling in Cuba, and just to hear your thoughts on that text as maybe a bridge between the first Scarface and the second.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point, because there is this sort of underbelly of Miami trope that was going on then. Aren't there references to Miami in The Godfather, where it's about like Jewish crime bosses running Miami in Godfather too? I knew you would know. You know, like, yeah, that has been there as well. But I think for me, I get some traction there when I'm comparing that 1950s representation of Time Magazine. You know, the governor of Florida is on the cover. It is really promoting Miami, or promoting Florida, as a place for investment, as a place to move. You know, the population explodes of Florida in the 1950s. And yeah, there are some of those texts are presenting a grittier depiction of Miami, but nothing like you see in the 1980s when you know, Miami Vice and Scarface also have many imitators, so there's a bunch of movies, a bunch of TV shows that also focus on Miami then, but thanks for that good point.
Hi. My question is, I'm not a film scholar or a buff, but...
They're going to make you talk on the mic.
Sorry, for the people on the mic.
My question is about... I'm not a film buff and I'm not a film scholar, so I'm just reflecting on Chon Noriega's work on Between a Weapon and a Formula. Have we not gone beyond that trope?
I don't know. I don't think so. Because look at the Annenberg reports that have come out in the last couple of years around Latinx representation in film and TV. They are very bleak. I can't remember exactly, but I think it's something like 4.5% of speaking roles in that study from a few years ago were by Latinos in an industry based in Los Angeles. Shocking, horrific, terrible in the 2020s. So they're about to drop their next report, and they said that there's some better news in it, but you know, I guess you don't know, because you're not a pop culture consumer as much as others, but the numbers are really bad still in terms of Latinx representation in pop culture. I ended on a pessimistic note, saying it's not getting, we're not fixing the problem. There are some shows that I think, I'm especially interested in TV shows and for a lot of the book, and there are some shows that do give me some hope. I'll give you just one example. The show Sons of Anarchy, which is a motorcycle gang show set in Northern California, has a spinoff called Mayans MC, Motorcycle Club. And it tells the story of a rival bike gang that is all Latino in Southern California, in kind of the borderlands. And it tells this, this is the epilogue to the book, so I can't help but go off on this a little bit, but it tells a story very similar to the hugely popular show Sons of Anarchy, but it totally shifts the point of view to Latinx characters who are I don't need them to be sympathetic. I don't need to like them, but they are complex. They have like motivations that are more than just pointing a gun at a white person. They are ensnared in the drug trade, but have a complicated relationship to that. That is something that has been very rare with Latino, Latinx representations in the drug trade, because in shows like Breaking Bad, in shows like Narcos, they tend to be the killers, they tend to be the bad guys, they tend to be the bimbos who are on the arm of the kingpins. So to have a more complex representation is very important to me in terms of like where Narco-Media goes next. The show Mayans MC was created by the guy who created Sons of Anarchy, and then he left the show after a year and made the showrunner a person of color, an African-American guy who had been formerly incarcerated as a member of the drug trade, or participant in the drug trade. And the thing that he told Entertainment Weekly when he handed over kind of the keys to the show was, it's time for a white man to leave the building. And that is the title of the epilogue for that very reason, because Latinos have had extraordinarily limited access to behind the camera. So until we get behind the camera, I have no idea how this changes or how, you know, it gets better, so to speak.
That's amazing. Patricia, it was excellent. Thank you so much. And but there are other examples that are not in that I'm wondering, maybe that's a way to increase it. So I would like your opinion. I mean, Jane the Virgin, I forget how many seasons it went for, right? Talk about a telenovela. I mean, that's what it was. And then there was the one season of Broke, which I'm proud to say my son was a writer for that show, but it only ran for one season. And Jaime Camille was a lead, and they hadn't had a lead since Desi Arnaz, okay? Desi Arnaz. It's just ridiculous. So how is it that we're going to do this? And so my question to you is, maybe if we increased in a different area to help, you know, bring the other ones up. So is comedy maybe a way? I don't know. I'd love to hear what you say, so I can tell my son.
No, all right. First, I'll tell him to keep at it and keep working at it. Yes, there are many more shows on TV that tell Latinx stories. You mentioned Jane the Virgin, Ugly Betty, one of my favorites.
Yeah,
you know, that's not no longer even a new show anymore. But especially, you know, some of the streaming platforms were trying to, you know, appeal to diverser audiences. Hentified, all these shows that did so much. One Day at a Time, another really good one. But there is so much more TV being made right now that it doesn't change the fact that 5% are speaking roles, 5% of speaking roles are Latinos, because there's so many more speaking roles than there ever. I've been reading, you know, I read the industry news a lot, and it's there's not a lot of what do you call it, studio space in Southern California right now, because there's so much TV being made right now that there's no place to make it. Your son probably can speak to that. So there's a lot going on in terms of diversifying storytelling, but it's still does not reflect the fact that like 20% of the U.S., close to 20% of the U.S. calls themselves Latinos, and the number of speaking roles are very small. And then the next slide that I didn't show there was that of those speaking roles, many have negative connotations. So the Annenberg folks categorize the speaking roles in terms of villains, people who are impoverished, people who are, you know, who point a gun at someone. They do all this sort of layering to show you that even in those that small percentage of speaking roles that are by Latinx performers, they tend to be especially negative depictions. That's hard to quantify. I don't know how you quantify a negative depiction, but that's how they do it.
We have time for one more. Ina.
Hi, thank you. My name's Janann. I'm a Chicano Studies major here at the University of Minnesota.
That makes me
my
so
professor
happy.
Is Dr. Davalos up there, who asked the question about pop culture media. I have a question regarding the Latinidad. And so how do Latinos and their attitudes towards media representation kind of shape or form their own assimilation here in the United States, because you mentioned that Scarface was sold out, and there's lines, and I'm sure a lot of attendants were Latinos, specifically Cubans. So whether representation is negative or positive, how do you think that representation for Latinos in regarding the Latinidad shapes or kind of answers or defines their own assimilation here in the United States?
It's a big question, a good question. No, that's great. And it actually works well with the previous question. You know, one of the things that that the scholars who study the media industries will tell you is that Latinos are more likely to go to the movies than any other demographic group in the United States. Latinos go to the movies a lot, despite the fact that the movies are not made for them, typically. So Latinos are huge consumers of media. Everyone knows that, right? So I was worried someone would ask me the Latinidad question because it's in my subtitle and it's a huge argument in Latino studies. You're an undergrad in, so you know this. Like, is Latinidad even the right category to approach, you know, the 20% of the American population that I just mentioned? You know, there's lots of criticism that Latinidad or Latinx as a category has many exclusionary practices that have been associated with it. I don't even know what word to use anymore because, you know, we've gone to Latinx, but, you know, there, a new word will pop up by the time you graduate. Latine or Latin with an E at the end. So I'm very nervous about putting like the boundaries around Latinidad in my book. So when you read my book, you will, I'm being optimistic here, you will see a long and tortured part of the introduction that talks about, like, I am not 100% sure about this category, but I'm not abandoning it either, because we need some conceptual framework to talk about people whose roots are in Latin America and who identified as Latino, Latinx, Latinx, whatever term you want to use. And media is one of the places where those boundaries, I think, get challenged, questioned. It's questionable whether or not we can call Scarface a Latinx movie, a Latinx film, because it is about, I argue yes, because I think it is about some aspect of the Latinx experience in the United States. I think despite the fact that very few Latinos are associated with the making of the film, I think it's a horribly negative depiction of a particular Latinx population. It's still a Latinx film. I talked about Narcos a lot, you know, because I think a lot of people might be familiar with it. Is Narcos a Latinx text? You know, I'm not even sure it's like Narcos is a hugely transnational media product. So Narcos is written, I visited the writer's room for a few days in Los Angeles. Narcos is written by six American writers in a writing room in Los Angeles, but it's made, the first few seasons are made mostly in Latin America and mostly involving Latin American acting talent and writers, and or not writers, but directors. So, and then it beams into, like, you can be in Tehran and watch Narcos, or Moscow, or South Africa. Like Narcos is truly a global media property. So I'm not even sure we can call, like, Narcos a US media text at all. I almost fell off my couch when I still had cable a couple years ago, and I was flipping channels, and Narcos was being broadcast on Univision, and they just flipped the subtitles so that, like, the English was subtitled and the Spanish was not subtitled. So that is, like, that's one more layer to the fact that, so, like, Narcos, like, I just argued for the complexity, national and cultural complexity of Narcos. And then it's broadcast for US Latino audiences. I mean, like, you know. So I don't know if I answered your question about Latinidad. I'm very nervous about putting, like, boundaries around it, but I think I'm not yet willing to abandon it as a conceptual category, or I'm definitely not gonna abandon Latinx studies as sort of my intellectual space. Thanks a lot.
So do we have time for one more, Bionette, or should? Yes. Right, you write that in the second row.
Hello. My name is William. I'm a political science student. I was in Professor Pierce's class on the American Dream last semester. And I'm curious about how you see this sort of narco-media affecting politics as, in terms of like political rhetoric and the way politicians talk and act around Latinidad and around drug policy. As well as how you see it affecting and informing policy itself?
Oh my God, I love this question and fear this question so much. I gave a talk, like a work in progress talk, to my home department at Notre Dame a few years ago in the very early stages of this, and my department like slammed me. They're like, what on earth are you doing here? Like, you're saying that like people are locked up because of Scarface or Miami Vice? Do you think that the prison warden watches my, it's a very unimaginative colleague. I hope they're not zooming. Do you think, you know, the prison warden watches, you know, narcos, and that's why he locks up Colombian Americans? Okay. No, I do not believe in a direct cause. I don't think that cause and effect is that direct. I don't think people are sitting in a jail right now because of narcos. But I do think that US Latinos and African Americans are exponentially more likely to spend time in a prison in the United States. And the number one cause of our mass incarceration, the number one reason for or charge in mass incarceration is a drug charge. So I do not think that we can disconnect the perceptions created in pop culture that black and brown people and other racialized minorities are involved with drugs to the fact that we are locking up black and brown people at such an incredibly alarming rate in this country. So I can't prove cause and effect, but I can say as a scholar, as an interpreter, I want to connect our representational patterns that go way back into the 19th century around drugs to our contemporary incarcerational carceral practices and policing practices. I mean, I made it a special point to say in the presentation, policing and punishing, because we have to look at who gets pulled over, who gets suspected of harder drug charges. The crack and cocaine disparity is a really good example of that. I can't prove that Scarface has anything to do with that. I hope you will leave this talk convinced that our representational practices are connected to our carceral practices. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Dr. Jason Ruiz, for a fascinating talk and for that conversation. Those of you who are here, please join us for the reception. And I'm assuming, Jason, you're willing to engage more about your book there. Okay, great. Thanks, everyone.